الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فما زلنا ولله الحمد نشرح كتاب أو نترجم شرح كتاب الله العزيز، وهو كتاب التفسير المعروف بتيسير الكريم الرحمن في تفسير كلام المنان للشيخ عبد الرحمن بن ناصر السعدي رحمه الله تعالى. وكنا قد وصلنا في الأسبوع القادم إلى آية رقم 20. نعم 20 verse number 20. وكنا على وشك أن نسرع في آية رقم 21. وكنا قد سردنا بعض الفوائد التي قد سردها الإمام السعدي رحمه الله التي استنبطها من القصة. And so last time we stopped at verse number 20. Actually we were mentioning the benefits that the Shaykh deduced from the story. And then we had a couple more benefits left, and now we were going to begin with verse number 21. The last thing I remember discussing is the fact that we deduced from the story that it is encouraged for the person to do his actions on the down low. Finish off your affairs on the down low. Specifically, in times where you might be there might be a fitna pertaining to your deen. Tayyib, you don't expose yourself to something that will cause you harm. And for the person to learn how to be, under the table kind of style, for himself and his brothers, in order to protect the Muslims and the believers, and for them not to be exposed to harm. Because of the way that the people of the cave handled their business, they gave him the money, they said, go to the Medina, get us some food, but slow down, take it easy, be underground. Why? Because if they catch you, they're either gonna kill us or make us go back to their deen, their religion. And so, يعني, if you don't act right, we will all pay for the consequences. So it's upon a Muslim to protect himself and his fellow Muslims because of the actions of these brothers. Another benefit was the fact, ومنها شدة رغبة هؤلاء الفتية في الدين وفرارهم من كل فتنة في دينهم وتركهم أوطانهم في الله. Another benefit is the extreme keenness of these young men pertaining to their deen, their religion. How sincere they were to their religion.
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Mr. Late. La ba'as habibi. And them running away from every fitna in their deen and leaving alone their homes for the sake of Allah. Leaving alone their homes for the sake of Allah. So let's say you live in the Philippines, huh? And in the Philippines there's a lot of fitna. A lot of women who are not dressed properly. A lot of alcohol. A lot of marijuana, a lot of, you know what I'm saying, gambling. Aywa. And you have the ability to live among the Muslims. A person who's looking for the hereafter will try to run away, even if you were born there. Because, I mean, you belong to the country. يعني, we are Muslims before we are Chinese or European, Filipino, whatever. The ethnicity is insignificant when it comes to faith. This is the most important thing, is Islam. So wherever you are able to apply Islam better, this is where you want to try to be. Hala, not everybody has the ability to do so. Then Allah does not give a soul more than he can handle. But for those of us who have the opportunity, if they can live here, bring their families over here, it's far better than remaining over there. And I say the same thing about Lebanon. Even in Lebanon, if you want to compare to here, Lebanon is very much similar to the Western countries. Specifically, if you go to Beirut and some of the areas, يعني, it is not exactly that you will not know that you're in a Muslim land. Unless you go to certain areas where you see, alhamdulillah, the sisters are covered up and what have you. Otherwise, you think you're in Italy, man. They say, what's going on over here? I don't know if you've ever watched the TV, but they have some Lebanese channels. If you see them, you know what I'm saying. I don't advise you to see them, by the way. But I'm just saying, in case you have ever seen them in the past, you will know what I'm saying. So the idea is this, these young men, they left alone their homes for the sake of Allah, running away from fitna. Running away from trials and temptations and what have you. Whatever you can worship Allah better, this is where you're supposed to be. Right? Everybody knows the hadith of the man who killed 99 souls, then he killed 100, then he went asked about the most knowledgeable person, and he was directed towards him. He came and said, look, I killed 100 people, but I want to repent to Allah. Is there any, can I repent to Allah? So the scholar told him, of course, man, who can stop you from repentance? But what did he tell him? He said, but you live in an evil land. Many people are corrupt around you. You need to leave this land and move to this such and such city. In that city there are righteous people worshiping Allah. Go and live with them. In order to change your lifestyle of being a serial killer, you have to leave the environment where it encourages you to be a serial killer. You want to go to a place where people are not about killing, so you will pick up from their habits. Yani this is known. You come over here, you pick up some Saudi habits, some Arab habits. When you go back to the Philippines, you act a little different than before you ever came here, because you've learned some things from here. And if you go to another country, you learn from their customs. The human being picks up. So if you live among evil people, you're going to get some evil. And if you live among good people, you're going to learn some good. So the sheikh, the scholar, told him, go to that country. Huh? He wound up dying on the way. The bottom line of the hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed the angels of mercy to take him, although he had never performed a good deed. He didn't get the chance to do salah. He didn't get the chance to fast. He didn't get the chance to do nothing. All he did was he repented to Allah from his ex-lifestyle, and he was migrating for the sake of Allah towards a new life. He died on the way before he even got there. But the mercy of Allah encompassed him, and he was accepted among the repenters, and he died as a believer. He died as a person who Allah has accepted the repentance. Why? Because he was only migrating to the good land. He didn't even make it there yet. So from this hadith, the scholars deduce the importance of living among the Muslims. And wherever there is righteousness, then you need to be in that environment, because it will help you worship Allah. If you have 5 friends and all of them pray in the masjid, at the time of prayer and you're hanging out with them, you have no place to be but at the masjid. I mean, they go to the masjid to pray, you hang out with them, you're going to go with them to the masjid because that's where they go. And hang out with 5 people who don't go to the masjid, chances are at the time of the salah, you're not going to go to the masjid. Because they're not going to wait for you outside while you go in and do salah, wait for the adhan, then the iqamah, then the salah, then you say the adhkar, then you pray the sunnah, then you leave. If they don't do salah, they're going to leave you. Say, look man, I don't know, 40 minutes, that's a long time. We could go do A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So you can hang out with them if you want to do the salah, or you say, forget about the salah, I'll pray when I get home. And you keep hanging out with them. This is a simple example with 5 people. What about the whole country? You know what I'm saying? Another benefit that the Shaykh mentioned, ذكر ما اجتمع عليه الشر من المضار والمفاسد الداعية لبغضه وتركه. وأن هذه الطريقة هي طريقة المؤمنين المتقدمين والمتأخرين لقولهم ولن تفلحوا إذا أبدا. Among the benefits from this particular story is the importance of mentioning evil. The importance of mentioning evil and what it contains from harm. Huh? What it contains from harm, which makes the people hate it, which causes hatred in the heart towards evil, and makes the people want to leave it alone. The Shaykh said, verily this is the method of the believers from old days and in current times. And because of this statement, وَلَن تُفْلِحَ وَدًا أَبَدًا, and you will never be successful. And remember the brothers who were in the cave, when they made it in the cave, and they started conversating with one another, they started speaking about their people. They said, our people have taken a God besides Allah. You know? And if we were to do the same, this will be the most outrageous thing. And would they just only bring in evidence for their belief system? They were mentioning يعني, the corruption in order for the souls to hate it. So it's a sunnah for the da'iya, a person who invites people to Islam. It's one thing to show the beauty of Islam. It's another thing to show how ugly this belief is. How bad this belief is. Wa'alaikum salam wa rahmatullah, Mr. Late. Mr. Late number 2. Since somebody already beat you for the title. Aywa, 9:15, mashaAllah. So it's the sunnah and the da'wah to mention evil. Describe the examples of evil. Tell the person, Ya Akhi, how are you going to say that there are 3 gods in one? How do you dare to claim that Allah has a son? How do you claim that the saint can help you? This is outrageous. This is unacceptable. You have to mention it to the people, even after they become Muslims, in order for it to become deep in their mind, in their right understanding, that this is something you can never go back to. So this is his da'wah. This is in da'wah. To beautify the truth and to make the falsehood, alaykum salam, and to make the falsehood ugly. You have to show how ugly the falsehood is. Huh? If there are two women that you want to marry, or if there are two women and you're going to marry one of them, and one of them, you could give the example, you could show how beautiful Islam is, because it is beautiful. And it doesn't need me or you to show how beautiful it is. It's beautiful just by nature. Allah created it beautiful. And this is enough for somebody to want to come in. But at the same time, you have to let them know somehow that what you have is very ugly. Eventually. So they will know that it's not like, Allah, there are two pretty things and they're choosing the one that is nicer. It's one that is beautiful and one that is very ugly. They're opposites. There's nothing that is close to Islam, but just a little, يعني not as good. No such thing. It's either Islam or nothing. Either you have three gods, or five gods, or 100 gods. Or you have no god. Or you have one god. There's no other option. Either Islam and the call of one god, and believing in all of the prophets and the messengers and all of the books and all of the angels, or it's something that has nothing to do with that. You believe in some and you disbelieve in some, you add and you delete, you change, you innovate, يعني شيء عجيب. So Islam is pretty, and anything else is ugly. So these brothers here, not only they mention the virtue of Tawheed, of the oneness of Allah, but they also criticize their people for their disbelief, and for taking other gods besides Allah, and how evil that is. And if we were to do like them, we would be astray. So this is also from the Sunnah. This is among the benefits that the Shaykh, may Allah mercy on him, deduced. Now verse 21, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. الله says, وكذلك أعثرنا عليهم ليعلموا أن وعد الله حق وأن الساعة لا ريب فيها إذ يتنازعون بينهم أمرهم فقالوا بنوا عليهم بنيانا ربهم أعلم بهم قال الذين غلبوا على أمرهم لنتخذن عليهم مسجدا. Somebody read verse 21 in English please. 21. Yes, Mr. Jamil. Raise your voice, Habibi.
In blasphemy, their case, know to the people
أيوة.
That they might know that the promise of Allah is true.
نعم.
And that there can be no doubt about the how.
Yes.
Remember, when they, the people of the city, disputed among themselves about their case, they said, construct a building over them.
Yes.
Their Lord knows best about them. Then those who won their point said, most probably the disbelievers. We verily shall build a place of worship over them.
Okay. Jazakallah khair. The Shaykh says, rahimahullah, يخبر الله تعالى أنه أطلع الناس على حال أهل الكهف. وذلك والله أعلم بعدما استيقظوا وبعثوا أحدهم يشتري لهم طعاما وأمروه بالاستخفاء والإخفاء فأراد الله أمرا فيه صلاح للناس وزيادة أجر لهم وهو أن الناس رأوا منهم آية من آيات الله المشاهدة بالعين المشاهدة بالعيان على أن وعد الله حق لا شك فيه ولا مرية ولا بعد بعدما كانوا يتنازعون بينهم أمرهم فمن مثبت للوعد وللجزاء ومن ناف لذلك فجعل قصتهم زيادة بصيرة ويقين للمؤمنين وحجة على الجاحدين وصار لهم أجر هذه القضية. The Shaykh, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him, said, Allah informed us that he informed the people about the condition of these people of the cave. And this, and Allah knows best, was after they woke up. And they sent one of them to buy some food. And they asked him to be on the down low. And to be secretive in the manner that he purchases the food. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted something that would be beneficial for the people. Allah decreed that something should happen in their case that will be beneficial to the people. And it will be an increase in reward for them. And that is that the people have seen in these people of the cave a sign from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they are able to see with their own eyes. The fact that the promise of Allah is the truth, that there's no doubt in it.
Wa
alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. So the fact that the promise of Allah, there's no doubt in it whatsoever. After they were disputing with among themselves regarding their affair. So, and what is intended? Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. What is intended here? Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. So basically, the people were disputing their affair at that time. Now here's what happened, wallahu a'lam, according to some narrations, according to some athar, يعني traces of the story. Is that when these men, when one of the young men came out, the people recognized them. And because their story had been already famous, that there were some young men who had run away in the previous times, a few hundred years ago, they ran away from the king, and nothing was ever heard about them since. And according to some stories, and I'm not sure about the reference, I need to double check that. But anyways, they came with a currency, a kind of money that was no longer available at that time. So when he came to purchase the food, the people recognized that this is probably one of the people of the cave. Maybe if you live in right now, okay? 300 years ago, people dressed different. People looked different. Huh? People acted different. And 300 years from now, things will change. You see what I'm saying? Even in the 1960s, 70s, you know, the tight pants with the big elephant feet, that was the style. Pants are about to rip. يعني, I don't know how the person would even walk in them. And having a big afro, you know, what do you call that dude who, whatever, anyways, I'm not going to go there. That change. People change and the fashion changes. So these people, this man came 300 and some years later, maybe the people recognized, man, you don't look like a dude from the city right now. Maybe he had some money anyways, people identified that this is, maybe these are the people of the cave whom this story has become famous. So this was a sign for these people that verily Allah can do whatever. This is a miracle from Allah that you're seeing with your own eye. Huh? That these people were protected by Allah for so many years and they're still alive. يعني only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can do this. This was a mercy from Allah to the people during the time in order for them to confirm their belief for those who believe. So they used to dispute among themselves, is there going to be resurrection? Is there not going to be resurrection? And you know, believing in resurrection is one of the tenets of faith. If you disbelieve in the resurrection, you are a disbeliever. Even if you claim La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and even if you claim whatever you claim, if somebody rejects the fact that Allah will send people out from their graves on the day of judgment for judgment, then he has went outside of Islam. Because you remember, there are things that will bring you into Islam and there are things that will get you out of Islam. So you have to come in and you don't want to do anything that will get you out. How are you going to reject resurrection? You cannot. And the disbelievers who were يعني, unintelligent, because the Jews and the Christians confirmed resurrection and the day of judgment. The disbelievers of the time, at the time the Quraysh, at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, they rejected resurrection to begin with. They didn't believe that anything will happen after you die. And they struck some examples. وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقًا قَالَ مَنْ يُحْيَ الْعِظَامَ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ. Allah says in the Quran Surah Yasin about one of the disbelievers who came to the Prophet ﷺ and he had with his hand a bone that was falling apart, disintegrating bone that was from the earth. He said, you're claiming that your God is going to bring this back? You're claiming that your God is going to bring this back and on the day of judgment? So Allah says, وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقًا. And this guy, he struck an example for us. He struck an example. Do you think God is going to bring this back? Allah says, وَنَسِيَ خَلْقًا. And he forgot his own creation. How did you come? You didn't come from a bone. But you came from a drop. From liquid. Not even a solid matter. From liquid. And now you have bones. So if Allah is able to bring you from liquid, make you bones, then bringing you from bone back to bone is even easier. And another way to look at it, who created you? If Allah was able to bring the creation the first time, it is easier to bring them back. Which is easier? For me to go and make one of these by myself, I have to go buy this material, and I have to go buy this, and I have to carve it, and do all the work, or for me to disassemble this, and then reassemble it. Reassembling it is easier than making a new one. If Allah created the creation, bringing them back is easier than creating them the first time. And Allah created them the first time. So how do you accept the first and reject the second? It doesn't make sense. Huh? It does not make any sense. Logic, Allah uses in the Quran logic. You see it with your own eye, ya Shaykh. Put in the ground a seed. Then you see a tree in a couple of weeks. So how? If Allah is able to allow this tree to come out from one little tiny seed, Allah is not going to be able to bring you back after you die. But the disbelievers, subhanAllah, they do not understand. They just don't understand. Not because things don't make sense, because they don't want to understand. They reject, they hate the truth. They hate the truth. Some people, wallah, hate the truth. As soon as you tell them the truth, they know what inside, and they hate it right away. And they don't want to say, don't tell me nothing. Don't continue, man. I don't want to hear this. I'm okay. I know what I'm doing. I know life. I'm happy. They tell you all this nonsense. And you know, and he knows that this is a bunch of nonsense. Junk. Just talk too much. The truth is too powerful. And as soon as you present it to the people, either they will accept it or they will reject it. And so, the people who don't want to accept Islam, they don't like the truth. There's nothing wrong with Islam. And we've said this, and we will always say this, there's absolutely nothing wrong with Islam. Even with the propaganda and the bad news that they have about us, it still does not stop people from entering into the religion of Allah. Because they are just working hard to try to destroy Islam. As Allah says, يُرِيدُونَ لِيُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ. Allah says that disbelievers, they want to extinguish the light of Allah with their mouths. They want to put out the light of Allah. As-salamu wa rahmatullah. وَاللَّهُ مَتُمُّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. And Allah will complete His light even if the disbelievers hate it. And this is very important for us to understand. Anyways, so these people were disputing whether there's going to be a resurrection or there's not going to be a resurrection. So when they've seen this live example of these people being resurrected after being put to sleep for 300 some years, this was means of confirmation that verily Allah is able to bring people out from their graves. So this was an increase in certainty for the believers, and this was an established proof against the disbelievers. This became a proof against the disbelievers who rejected the resurrection to begin with. And then these young men got the reward because of this issue. وَشَهَرَ اللَّهُ أَمْرَهُمْ وَرَفَعَ قَدْرَهُمْ حَتَّى عَظَّمَهُمُ الَّذِينَ اطَّلَعُوا عَلَيْهِمْ وَقَالُوا ابْنُوا عَلَيْهِمْ بُنْيَانًا اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِحَالِهِمْ وَمَآلِهِمْ. وَعَلَيْكُمْ السَّلَامُ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ. معكم السلام. Later, Abdul Hadi. Aywa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the affair of these young men famous. They became famous. And who can give me the proof that they are famous? The people of the cave. How? What's the proof that they are famous? Come on, man. This is as clear as the sun right now.
Because when you were out, the story already came up that all the people know about them.
Yes. What's a very close one? That's exactly what it is. But this is a real life example right now.
They are the offspring of the famous people, kings.
No. They're famous because we're sitting over here speaking about them right now. Yes, if you were not famous, nobody would even mention you.
Because
the Tawheed
is very strong.
Yes, well, I mean, that's what made them famous. But they're famous because we're sitting here right now, Allah knows how many years later, hundreds and thousands of years later, sitting here in another country with something that has nothing to do with it, and we're speaking about them in details. You don't get more famous than that. Huh? Even if you were on TV, maybe at the time there was no TV, so you can't really watch the same clip again. But we are speaking about these brothers right now, and they must be famous. And as we do it every Friday, brothers read about them. Every Friday Muslims read the story of the people of the cave. It's called Al-Kahf, the people of the cave, the cave. This is as famous as you get. If you are mentioned in the book that will remain until the day of judgment, the book that will never be changed, the book that is preserved by Allah, you're mentioned there, this is as famous as you get. You can't get any more famous than that. Any other book might be destroyed. This one is not going to be destroyed. Until the end of time, the Quran will be taken up when the people will no longer live according to its legislation. But this is another discussion. This will be towards the very, very end. Tayyib, so they're famous, ya akhwan. That's why we're sitting here, subhanAllah, speaking about them. Now, when the people disputed among them, about them, one of them said, we should build a masjid upon them. We want to build a masjid upon them. أي نعبد الله تعالى فيه ونتذكر به أحوالهم وما جرى لهم وهذه الحالة محظورة نهى عنها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وذم فاعليها ولا يدل ذكرها هنا على عدم ذمها فأن السياق في شأن تعظيم أهل الكهف والثناء عليهم وأن هؤلاء وصلت بهم الحال إلى أن قالوا ابنوا عليهم مسجدا بعد خوف أهل الكهف الشديد من قومهم وحذرهم من الاطلاع عليهم فوصلت الحال إلى ما ترى. Now listen to this. Here, the Shaykh mentions the following. The people decided, said, let's build a masjid upon where these people died, basically. Let's build a masjid over them in order for us to worship Allah and remember the affairs and what has happened to them. Now the Shaykh said, and this reality is something that is Islamically forbidden. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warned us from taking this particular action. And he عليه الصلاة والسلام said, لعن الله اليهود والنصارى اتخذوا قبور أنبيائهم مساجد. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, may Allah curse the Jews and the Christians. They have taken the graves of their people, of their so-called righteous people, as places of worship. This is a form of shirk. This is a form of associating foreigners with Allah. And this is happening right nowadays. You see in the Christians, when some priest or some pope or what have you dies, they bury him in the church. Huh? And the people take the place of death as a place of worship because they think there's a special blessing over there. Even if that person is being punished in his grave. But they don't claim that. They claim that he went to God and he's having a good time up there. And they, you know, they make... And this is when you read the news, you'll be shocked how straightforward the disbelievers are in confidence. They're very confident about something that they have no right to be confident about. So you see, whenever somebody dies, they say that he went to the Father, he's in heavens right now. He left us alone to a peaceful place in heavens. Where did he get this information from? Did he send you a fax? Did he go upstairs and send you a fax? Oh, I'm having a good time in heaven. How do you claim? A Muslim can never say, well, this person went to paradise. Allah knows best. Only Allah knows whether you're going to go to paradise or you're going to go to hell. We can never make this claim unless we have a textual evidence that this person is going to heaven. Such as the Prophet ﷺ telling a man, you are among the people of paradise. Then this is done. We make that claim because of the claim of the Prophet ﷺ, and as the Prophet ﷺ does not speak from his own desire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed him. But nowadays, if one of the brothers die, I cannot say that he's in Jannah. We hope that he's in Jannah, we make supplication for him to go to Jannah and to be protected from the fire, but we can never make this claim. Anyways, taking graves and building a grave, a masjid, I'm sorry, over a grave is something that is Islamically haram. And a masjid, if you go back to your home country, we have some of these back in our countries. If you go to a country where you know there's a grave in the masjid, it is prohibited for you to pray in this masjid. Your salah in this masjid is unacceptable. Because the salah in this masjid is unacceptable. If there's a grave in the masjid. Tayyib, graves don't belong in the place. Yes.
How about the grave of the Prophet?
The grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not in the masjid. He was buried in the hijra of Aisha. He was buried in Aisha.
Outside.
Then in the hundreds of years later, when they reconstructed the place, then they kind of included it and the people think it's part of the masjid. At the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the masjid wasn't the whole haram that you see right now. Aywa. No, he alayhi salatu salam, he had the rooms, there were rooms around the masjid. There was one for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, there was one for his hijra with Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. So his coming to the masjid was close. And the evidence for that is when he والسلام, used to do i'tikaf during Ramadan, he would put his head out from the masjid to the room of Aisha and she would wash his hair. Her room was right near the masjid. Then he didn't even leave the masjid. He would get his hair washed while he's in the masjid, but he would only put his head out. Because her room was right next to the masjid. But he was in the masjid. You understand what I'm saying? They wouldn't establish the jama'ah in her house. They would establish the jama'ah in the masjid. Her house were right near the masjid. So afterwards, the umara, those who were in charge of the Muslims, the least they moved away from righteousness, the more they started doing their own things. This is something very common. So now the people assume that the grave of the Prophet ﷺ is part of the masjid, but it is not. Okay, this is how they have now built the masjid. But there's a separation of partition. That's why you see there's always a haris there with a stick. As soon as you see the people starting going to make dua, he hit him. Because this is shirk. And some people go ask the Prophet ﷺ for things. They send him a little note. My son is handicapped and what have you. Ya akhi, Islam is the opposite of that. This is what Islam came to stop. Don't ask nobody for nothing. Even if he's a prophet or the messenger, and he's dead, how are you going to ask him for things? And Allah is right there. All you have to do is ask Allah. Why would you ask the Prophet ﷺ who's dead in his grave, and Allah is the one who answers your request, and you don't ask him? This is shirk. This is what the Christians do. This is what the Jews do. This is what the Buddhists do. The Hindus do. A lot of them confirm the presence of a creator, but they go to worship others than him, to get to him. And the commandment is that you go directly to God. That is Islam. That is Tawheed. That is the oneness of Allah. That you worship Him alone, you supplicate to Him alone, you ask for assistance from Him alone, you dedicate your love to Him alone, only to Allah. Because Allah is the only one who deserves all that. And the prophets and the messengers were only a sample, an example of how to do that. If you want to learn how to worship your God, look how the messenger did it. Don't go worship the messenger. Look how he did it. The way he does it, this is how God wants it. Because he sent him to you as an example to teach you. So you don't worship the messenger. You worship God the way the messenger does. Because he knows more than you. Because he received the revelation, you didn't. You understand what I'm saying? So Islamically, it is not permissible to build a masjid over a grave. Nor to pray in this masjid. Now the Sheikh said, a person who does this is to be reprimanded. And the fact that it's mentioned in the story does not indicate the permissibility. Because this is only telling the event that happened in the past. That's why when the brother Jameer read, it says most likely the people who made this decision were the disbelievers. It was the disbelievers who said, let's build a masjid upon them. Because the believers will never build a masjid upon a grave. Because this is Islamically prohibited. So the Sheikh said here the issue, the story is about honoring and praising the people of the cave. And what has that it, to the point that the people honored them so much that they wanted to build a masjid over their graves. That does not indicate that it is permissible to build a masjid over the grave. You understand what I'm saying? So in the Quran it mentions stories and it doesn't mean that it is permissible to do that. Tayyib, like Yusuf alayhi salatu salam and Imra'a and the wife of the Aziz who wanted to attack him and have a relationship with Yusuf. And he ran away from her. And he escaped from her. Now, just because it's mentioned in the story, in the Quran, it doesn't mean that a woman has the right to go and attack a man who's not lawful for her. You understand what I'm saying? But it's mentioned in the Quran. Here, this is only mentioned in the story that the people disputed among themselves. They said, man, these people are too great. Now we've got to build a masjid upon their grave. But it doesn't mean that it is permissible. This is only speaking about what Allah is informing us, what the people wind up deciding at that time. Everybody understands this. Now, if you ever go to your home country and you find that there's a masjid where there's a grave, if he doesn't say Alhamdulillah, it's not permissible to say Alhamdulillah. Because the hadith says, if the Muslim sneezes and he says Alhamdulillah, you say Alhamdulillah. If he doesn't say Alhamdulillah, as if you didn't see anything or hear anything. Okay? So it's conditional for you to say Alhamdulillah, for us to say Alhamdulillah. Then what do you say in return? Aywa. You hear some people say Yahdina wa Yahdikumullah. This is not from the Sunnah, by the way. This is from the people's own innovations. The Sunnah is to say Yahdikumullah wa Yuslihu Balakum. May Allah guide you and rectify your condition. So if somebody says, don't say Yahdina wa Yahdikum Allah or anything else that you think is okay. Because the Sunnah came with a particular expression and we follow the same expression in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So anyways, if you see a grave in your home country and a masjid, do not pray there. Even if there's no other masjid, pray at home. Jama'ah is no longer an obligation upon you. Praying in congregation is no longer an obligation if there's no other masjid but the masjid where there's a grave. Because it is not permissible to worship Allah in a place where there's a grave. The masajid are the places where Allah is worshipped alone, not the graveyard, to bury someone who people claim that he is righteous or purify him on behalf of Allah and say that he is righteous. This is something that no Muslim can do because we do not know the condition of the people in the grave. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about them. So we cannot claim that this person is being honored in his grave or being tortured because this is speaking about the unseen and nobody knows the unseen but Allah. So this is very important for us to understand.
Sir.
Yes, sir.
May I have a question?
Yes.
About the grave. Here, after the put in the dais, they are praying there in, beside the grave.
What kind of prayer? Their dua making prayer? The janazah prayer is something that is Islamically legislated. So doing the janazah prayer is something you have to do, actually. It's a fard kifaya. It's a communal obligation. If some Muslims carry it out, the rest are not held accountable. But somebody has to do the janazah for a Muslim who died. So that particular prayer is not praying for the person, it's not praying to the person, praying for the person. And even if you go to a grave, you visit a graveyard, you can make dua for them. Oh Allah, forgive them. Oh Allah, have mercy on them. Oh Allah, you ask Allah to give them. The problem is nowadays some Muslims or so-called Muslims, they go and ask the people in the grave. Say, look man, I need some money. I need a house. I need a wife. If Sheikh, the guy is in there, man, what are you going to ask him for? So this is the problem here. So the janazah prayer is something that is, you're praying for them actually. You're asking Allah to have mercy on them and to forgive them. This is legislated, this is an obligation. But don't go there and do salah like if Brother Ahmad bin Adalla. On his computer he showed me some crazy footage from India. From India. Big mashayikh. You think the mashayikh man, beard like this and big turban, you'll think he's the imam. He's sitting there, wallahi, he wants to go to the grave. Have a big grave with a green fancy silk fabric and they are making prostration for the grave. And they are they're trying to receive blessing. They wipe themselves on the thing. This is all crazy. Even the Kaaba. What you see people doing on the Kaaba is haram. Innovation. People, actually love, يعني, subhanAllah. The shaitan is working 24/7 to, if there's one way you can go to the fire, guaranteed it'll never come out, through shirk. So the shaitan, this is his favorite door. You may fornicate, you may steal, you may kill, but if you are a believer, Allah might forgive you, and even if Allah doesn't forgive you and you go to the fire, one day you'll be taken to paradise. Because you died without associated partners with Allah. If the shaitan doesn't make you fornicate, and doesn't make you steal, and doesn't make you kill, but you fall into shirk, you will never go out of the hellfire. This is the easiest and the most favorite door for the shaitan. So all these are forms of shirk. Ya akhi, this Kaaba, why do we honor it? In order to honor Allah. We're not honoring the building. That's why Umar radiallahu anhu, the black stone, when he came to kiss it, he said, wallahi, I know you're a stone. You do not benefit or harm. But had I not seen the Messenger of Allah kiss you, I would never kiss you. He only kissed it because the Prophet ﷺ and he's only following the Sunnah. But it's a stone.
Umar wala Abu Bakr.
Umar. Umar, Habibi. It doesn't matter. Review it later, inshallah. Whether Umar or Abu Bakr, I know it's Umar, but assuming it's Abu Bakr, no problem. The idea is behind it is that the way they understood these things. It's your stone, you don't benefit or harm. But the Prophet ﷺ kissed you, so I'm doing the same thing. So the Kaaba in and within itself, we only love the Kaaba because Allah loves this location. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had built this house. This is the first house built for the people to worship Allah. And people come from long distances in order to do tawaf around the Kaaba. But to think that there's a blessing in the fabric, or there's a blessing in the rock, or a blessing in the stone, is outrageous. The blessing is from Allah. And Allah is the one who blesses. The Kaaba in within itself is only a construction. That's why at the end of time, as it comes in the narration of the Prophet ﷺ, some young man from Ethiopia, he will come and he will destroy the Kaaba rock by rock. This Kaaba will be destroyed, by the way, before the Day of Judgment. So the building is nothing. It's because Allah commanded us to honor it, we honor it. But for the people to try to get some blessing from it, it's unacceptable. So you don't kiss the Kaaba and you don't wipe yourself with the Kaaba, you don't do nothing. You do tawaf. If you see the black stone and there's no traffic, you kiss it following the way of the Prophet ﷺ, done deal. That's it. That's it. That's all we need to do. But you will see ignorant Muslims coming from all over, you know, the other side of the world. They're used to in their countries to worship graves, worship these things. They have shirk all over in their Islam. Some of them are no longer Muslims, subhanAllah. You can't be falling in shirk like this man and remain a Muslim. They don't know any better, so they come and do their own rituals. That they one person teaches another person and teaches another person without knowledge. And then the whole community wind up following away of a man, and that man doesn't know any better. That's why seeking knowledge is very important in Islam. You have to follow the Quran and the Sunnah, and not only that, not according to anyone, according to the understanding of the early generation of Muslims, according to the understanding of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ and the first three generations of Muslims, those who were close to the revelation, those who the revelation was coming down in their presence, those who would ask the Prophet ﷺ and Allah would reveal, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ, and they ask you, then Allah will answer their questions. These people understood because they seen the Prophet ﷺ do the actions with their own eyes. And seeing and hearing is better than only hearing. So those who came later, they only hear. We only hear that the Prophet ﷺ did such and such. They seen it with their own eye. So their understanding is better. And those who were closer to them, who learned from them, inevitably understood better. Now 1400 years later, people have misunderstood a lot of the textual evidences. Alaykum salam. No problem. Waalaikum salam wa rahmatullah. Ahlan wa sahlan. Hayyakumullah. Naam habibi. Barakallahu feek. Ha? Tayyib.
Masajid.
Ayywa.
We noticed one community, Muslim community in southern part of Mindanao, which is very close to our city. The government gave donation a lot. This art for the Muslim community to have masajid, to masjid. Because the mayors give donation for the Muslim community. But this this place, we know, we hear that this is not confirmed, but we hear some of this old man who lived this place, which is this place is a cemetery.
Before. Yeah.
So are they allowed to build the masjid in this place?
No. No. If it's a cemetery, if it's a known, recognized,
so that the masjid is existing.
So don't pray there. And the salah, the people are to be notified, and the scholars don't play with these things. Yeah, this is one of the things where the scholars say, yeah, destroy the masjid. Destroy the masjid and build it in another location. Waalaikum salam wa rahmatullah. Waalaikum salam wa rahmatullah. How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
Hey, what's up, what's
What should be the thing that we can just buy today?
Well, what you can do is you can. There are books already written about the impermissibility of praying in the masjid that has a grave. So you get a book showing the textual evidences from the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ about the fact that the people who do this are cursed and the fact that this is unacceptable. And he presented to the people concerned about this. He said, look, this is not permissible. This masjid needs to be destroyed and rebuilt in another location.
But the problem is if you make if you give some textual evidence from any, you will not accept, especially your Malik Islam.
Yes, oh, exactly. Yes.
So what is the, then how could we approach them?
You can, well, I mean, you have to evaluate the darar المفاسد والمصالح, the harm and the benefit. So if you feel that there's a benefit in you discussing this with these people, and you might be able to affect them or influence them somehow, get the person who's the most wise among them, and you know, try to show him that you honor him, say, I understand you're more Muslim than myself, and you've been born into Islam, I'm known as Muslim and what have you, and I'm sure your knowledge is far better than mine, that's why you probably have the means to accept the narration more than me, but this is what I have come across, and this is what some of the scholars say. You know, try to pave the way. If this person is going to reject you altogether, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah will not give you more than you can handle. You say, Barakallah fiqh, salam alaikum, and you grab yourself and you leave. Huh? Because if you're going to cause more fitna, then it becomes forbidden for you to enjoin the evil, to forbid the evil. If you're going to cause more evil, then don't forbid the evil. See what I'm saying? So this is يعني, to be done with the people who have the means to change it. But the bottom line is that this masjid should not be prayed in. If it has been confirmed that it's built in a cemetery, then this is يعني, outrageous. And it becomes worse if there's a special person who died there, as it is the case with many masajid. When there's a special so-called wali, or a person who is close to Allah, a friend of Allah, or a person who is a prophet, or you know, whoever they claim, Hassan al-Hussein, they believe that they died in this place, and they build a little dariyah for them, a little construction specific for them, and they put some fancy flowers and some fancy fabric, and the people try to seek blessings from these people. This is against the teachings of Islam. This is shirk. This is what Islam came to stop. Don't set up partners with Allah. Don't call on to other than Allah. Allah says in the Quran, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. In the Quran, Surah Al-Jinn, Allah says, and the masajid, the masjid, or the masajid are only for Allah. So do not call along with Allah anyone. The people go to the house of Allah to set up partners with Allah. So may Allah rectify the condition of the you know Muslims in the world. That's why يعني, we should learn in order to educate the people. And then you try your best. If it's going to cause you more harm, maybe they're going to call the government and put you in jail, and you know they're not going to listen to you, خلاص. You have done your part of enjoining the good and forbidding the evil, and the rest is upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not have to do anything more than that. But you should at least mention it to them. نعم. وفي هذه القصة دليل على أن من فر بدينه من الفتن سلمه الله منها, وأن من حرص على العافية عافاه الله, ومن أوى إلى الله أواه الله وجعله هداية لغيره, ومن تحمل الذل في سبيله وابتغاء مرضاته كان آخر أمره وعاقبته العز العظيم من حيث لا يحتسب, وما عند الله خير للأبرار. The Shaykh, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him, said, and this, in this story, there is an evidence, the fact that if somebody runs away and escapes with his deen, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect him. If somebody is running away with his religion from the place of tribulations and trials, where you know that if you live in X land, you are unable to live Islam properly. Like in some places, you cannot call the adhan outside the masjid. There's no speakers, there's nothing. The brothers in certain countries, they call the adhan in the masjid. Nobody hears him but the brother who is with him in the masjid. This is among the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that should be established on earth, because this is the earth of Allah. So if a person is unable to carry out the commandments of Allah, if you're unable to pray and fast and live your Islamic life in one country, then if you run away from that to a place where you're able to do so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will facilitate things for you. Based on the story, these people ran away from the people and they lived in the cave. Allah made them sleep in the cave for 300 some years because they were running away with their deen. And the Shaykh says, and whomever is keen on having afiyah, meaning having wellness, to be well, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make him or her well. And whomever returns to Allah, whomever returns to Allah, then Allah will accept him and he will make him or her a source of guidance for others. Let's just refer to him. Whenever I say him, I mean him and her. طيب. In Islam, often him is referred because of the predominance of the male. Nonetheless, when the Quran speaks about the gender, 99% it considers both male and female, unless in certain evidences where it is tahara. Aywa. Unless. Did you turn it on or off?
No,
on?
Before, off.
It was off this whole time?
No. It was a while ago. Put it off.
Hey, well, maybe close this curtain, man. I'm sweating over here. I don't know what's going on with you, brothers.
What did you say?
Turn it off now.
Did you turn it on right now? Good. It was off, yani.
No.
You just clicked the button, yes, sir.
It was off.
Yes, why was it off?
For 5 minutes. It's not 5 minutes.
It's four. We have 1,000 people breathing in here.
You're in Iceland, you know.
Iceland. Iceland. طيب. And whomever endures humility for the sake of Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, seeking the pleasure of Allah, then Allah, the end of his affair is going to be extreme honor. And this is something that is recognized and something that we can confirm. Every prophet and messenger had to endure humility. He was humiliated by his own people. Nuh alayhi salam, they used to make fun of him. They see him building an ark in the middle of the land. They said, man, what's wrong with you? Huh? There's no water over here. Why are you building an ark? And Allah had commanded him to build the ark. So he was belittled and humiliated because of his action. But what was the result? The same ark that they made fun of, he's the one that he was upon, and they were under the water. And Allah drowned them all. And who received the honor? Who do we speak about today? Nuh or his followers? Do you know the name of any of those who rejected him? Does any one of us know the name of one person who rejected Nuh? Does anyone ever mention them except when we speak bad about them? No. But everybody mentions Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Because the honor remained for him. And those who rejected him didn't receive nothing except hatred. We don't know who they are, but we hate them for the sake of Allah. Because they rejected the Messenger of Allah. And they made fun of the Messenger of Allah. See what I'm saying? So even if you deal with some sort of humility in the beginning, the bottom line is that Allah will honor you. Whether sooner or later. That's inevitable. So when you give da'wah, some of your family members, your Christian family members, when you start giving, inviting them to Islam, they're going to come and look down at you. Say, oh, now you become a terrorist, now you become an extreme, oh, we can't eat this anymore, and you can't do this anymore, and this, and they start trying to make you feel that you are crazy, huh? You've made some weird decisions. What's wrong with you? You were a normal person, all of a sudden you choose Islam, so now you're tying yourself with all these chains, you can no longer have fun, you have to pray, you have to fast. Why? Why are you doing this to yourself? And you may struggle in the beginning. But the bottom line is that Allah will honor you. Either sooner in this life, when all of them will respect you, even if they criticize you, inside they say, man, this guy, amazing. How can he pray 5 times a day? How can he fast? He doesn't eat from morning till evening. He went for Hajj. This is a big trip. They will honor you, even if their tongues cannot speak it. And another form of honoring is that when they die, they will die as disbelievers. When you die, you will die as believer, and you will be honored in the hereafter. They will be disgraced in the hereafter. So the bottom line is, even if you encounter some humility in this dunya, the outcome of things is for the believer. And the honor and the dignity will be given to the believer. So we be patient in the beginning. And Allah says, وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ لِلْأَبْرَارِ. And whatever is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is better for the righteous people. Wa bihada wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. MashaAllah. Wallah, timing is immaculate, Yasir. You come right with the next feature, huh? Wa bihada nakhtimu jalsatina. Wa jazakum Allah khayran. Subhanahu wa ta'ala wa bihamdik. Shadu la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.